Good day, YouTubers, or good evening, good afternoon, depending on what part of the globe you're residing in. It's a wonderful day here. Our Lord and Saviour is shining His glory for all to see. No doubt wishing that mankind would turn back to Him, give Him the thanks and praise that He so richly deserves, and to seek His guidance. And what a blessing that would be. There'd be no more war, no more greed, no more persecution, no more suffering, no more starvation, no more destruction, no more death. But sadly, as it's written, Jesus will have to return unless no flesh will be saved. On that matter, today's title will be Nothing Is As It Seems. I want to try and cram a lot into this posting, so bear with us. Hopefully it won't be too long, but there's a fair bit to go through. In fact, I've been learning so much this week that my head is spinning. Not only is man continuing in his defiance of God, our Creator, but I guess he believes the lie of Satan, who said in the garden that when you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will be like God, or be as gods. Well, it seems that certain individuals in this world are working to that, they're working to that effect. So I came across a New York Times article dated May the 13th of this year by Andrew Pollack. It's in the science section, and I thoroughly urge all right-minded individuals who should get to see this posting to take a look at it for yourself, but I will share it with you now. Now, this is the kind of thing that we notice in horror movies and sci-fi movies and that sort of thing, you know, the mad scientist. Well, here it is. Scientists talk privately about creating a synthetic human genome. Yes, they want to be God. They want to create their own human beings. Get ready for this. This is actually mind-boggling, and it just goes to show that there is no limit to the wickedness of man. That he'd even want to create a synthetic version of his own kind. Some nice pictures to look at. The first picture, I can only give you a description of it, but if you want to go to the New York Times site and look up the science section and that date that I just mentioned, May the 13th, then and quite interesting when you think that this has just been reviewed. So I've just realised that was Friday the 13th, was it not? Yeah, quite interesting. You know, as that's always considered a day of foreboding. Of course, the only reason that being, as far as I'm aware, is because of the mass execution of the Illuminati. Anyway, so the first picture shows a picture of could be a female hand, it might be a male hand, I'm not quite sure, lifting a tray out, and it says 60 trays contain the entire human genome as 23,040 different fragments of cloned DNA. And that credit is given to James King Holmes, who is the science source. Scientists are now contemplating the fabrication of a human genome, meaning they would use chemicals to manufacture all the DNA contained in human chromosomes. The prospect is spurring both intrigue and concern in the life sciences community, because it might be possible, such as through cloning, to use a synthetic genome to create human beings without biological parents. While the project is still in the idea phase and also involves efforts to improve DNA synthesis in general, it was discussed at a closed-door meeting on Tuesday at Harvard Medical School in Boston. The nearly 150 attendees were told not to contact the news media or to post on Twitter during the meeting. Organisers said the project could have a big scientific payoff and would be a follow-up to the original Human Genome Project, which was aimed at reading the sequence of the 3 billion chemical letters in a DNA blueprint of human life. The new project, by contrast, would involve, excuse me as I scroll up, not reading but rather writing the human genome, synthesizing all 3 billion units from chemicals. But such an attempt would have raised numerous ethical issues. Could scientists create humans with certain kinds of traits, perhaps people born and bred to be soldiers? Or might it be possible to make copies of specific people? Now, isn't it interesting that God's word says that in the final days, when he rains down his wrath upon this wicked earth, that men will seek death and not find it? Here is yet again that, you know, I don't know who it was it Nietzsche, someone who said, wasn't it, be careful what you wish for, you just might get it? Well, it seems to be the case, doesn't it? Or might it be possible to make copies of specific people? Would it be okay, for example, to sequence and then synthesize Einstein's genome? Drew Endy, a bioengineer at Stanford, and Laurie Zoloff, a bioethicist at Northwestern University, wrote in an essay criticizing the proposed project. If so, how many Einstein genomes should be made and installed in cells? And who would get to make them? Dr. Endy, though invited, said he deliberately did not attend the meeting at Harvard because it was not being opened enough to people and was not giving enough thought to the ethical implications of the work. George Church, a professor of genetics at Harvard Medical School and an organizer of the proposed project, said there had been a misunderstanding. The project was not aimed at creating people, just cells. It would not be restricted to human genomes, he said. Rather, it would aim to improve the ability to synthesize DNA in general, which could be applied to various animals, plants, and microbes. They're painting a picture which I don't think represents the project, Dr. Church said in an interview. He said the meeting was closed to the news media and people were asked not to tweet because the project organizers, in an attempt to be transparent, had submitted a paper to a scientific journal. They were therefore not supposed to discuss the idea publicly before publication. He and other organizers said ethical aspects have been amply discussed since the beginning. The project was initially called HGP2, or the Human Genome Synthesis Project, with HGP referring to the Human Genome Project. An invitation to the meeting at Harvard said that the primary goal would be to synthesize a complete human genome in a cell line within a period of 10 years. But by the time the meeting was held, the name had been changed to HGB Right, Testing Large Synthetic Genomes in Cells. The project does not yet have funding, Dr. Church said, though various companies and foundations will be invited to contribute, and some have indicated interest. The federal government will also be asked. A spokeswoman for the National Institute of Health declined to comment, saying the project was in too early a stage. Besides Dr. Church, the organizers include Jeff Boeck, director of the Institute for Systems Genetics at New York University, Langone Medical Center, and Andrew Hessel, a self-described futurist who works at the Bay Area software company Autodesk, and who first proposed such a project in 2012. Scientists and companies can now change the DNA in cells, for example, by adding foreign genes or changing the letters in the existing genes. This technique is routinely used to make drugs, such as insulin for diabetes, inside genetically modified cells, as well as to make genetically modified crops. And scientists are now debating the ethics of new technology that might allow genetic changes to be made in embryos. But synthesizing a gene or an entire genome will provide the opportunity to make even more extensive changes in DNA. For instance, companies are now using organisms like yeast to make complex chemicals like flavorings and fragrances. That requires adding not just one gene to the yeast, like to make insulin, but numerous genes in order to create an entire chemical production process within the cell. With that much tinkering needed, it can be easier to synthesize the DNA from scratch. Right now, synthesizing DNA is difficult and error-prone. Existing techniques can reliably make strands that are only about 200 base pairs long, with the base pairs being the chemical units in DNA. A single gene can be hundreds of thousands of base pairs long. Hundreds or thousands of base pairs long. To synthesize one of those multiple 200 unit segments have to be spliced together. But the cost and capabilities are rapidly improving. Dr. Endy of Stanford, who is a co-founder of a DNA synthesis company called Gen 9, said the cost of synthesizing genes has plummeted from $4 per base pair in 2003 to 3 cents now. But even at this rate, the cost for 3 billion letters would be $90 million. He said if costs continued to decline at the same pace, the figure could reach $100,000 in 20 years. So I guess this won't be happening in my lifetime. And I thank the Lord for that. What a future we're heading into. It just beggars belief, doesn't it? J. Craig Venter, the genetic scientist who synthesized a bacterial genome consisting of about 1 million base pairs. The synthetic genome was inserted into a cell and took control of that cell. While his first synthetic genome was mainly a copy of an existing genome, Dr. Venter and colleagues this year synthesized a more original bacterial genome, about 500,000 base pairs long. And actually, I'm just going to look to see if it's to hand. Got a horrible feeling it might not be, I don't know. So I'm just reaching for my Bible, because I just wanted to see whether, because you see, in this world we have a tendency to think it's humorous to, sorry, this is something else I want to show you, not today, maybe. Here we are. My trusty Bible. I just wanted to see that it was interesting that company called themselves Genesis 9. Let's see what Genesis 9 has to say. I mean, I'm not going to go through the whole chapter, but I just want to see what the basic. Yes, I know, I should know it all, but. Well, we live in such a distracting world that it is difficult to always know every part. I mean, I know some people can recite chapter and verse, but I've been learning recently, actually, that the Bible is not infallible, you know? That's interesting, actually. It's quite a short one. Let's just go through this. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air and upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you. Even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall you not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require, at the hand of every beast will I require it, and at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of man. Now that's interesting, that, isn't it? Because, see, it says about the beast there as well, like about killing animals. Now, but it's obviously not eating the blood of the animal, yeah? Now, we know that people like their rare steaks and so on, like, so that's in complete defiance of the Lord. But see how he actually places importance on animals. And I'm going to share with you, after when I've finished this little piece, the actual comments from people on this article. Because I find it quite interesting that it shows that there are very, very few that actually look upon this whole thing as being ungodly, wicked, and something that should be, you know, considered abhorrent and actually, you know, stand up and say, no, we mustn't do this wicked thing. You know, who are we to create human beings? Like, you know, this is terrible. You know, who are we to play God? Yeah? So I'll be showing you those comments, but, you know, that they're talking about the animals there, you know, just reminded me of what someone said in the comments section. So he says, and you, be fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth and multiply therein. And God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And I, behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you, neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there be any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, This is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will return my covenant which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the water shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth. And God said unto Noah, This is the token of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is upon the earth. And the sons of Noah that went forth of the ark were Shem, and Ham, and Japheth, and Ham is the father of Canaan. These are the sons of Noah, and of them was the whole earth overspread. And Noah began to be an husbandman, and he planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father, and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment, and laid it upon both their shoulders, and went backward, and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. And Noah woke from his wine, and knew that his younger son had done what his younger son had done unto him, and he said, Cursed be Canaan! A servant of servants shall be he unto his brethren. And he said, Blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. God shall enlarge Japheth, and he shall dwell in the tents of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. And Noah lived after the flood 350 years, and all the days of Noah were 950 years, and he died. So interesting that company should call themselves Gen 9, isn't it? Dr. Boeck is leading an international consortium that is synthesising the genome of yeast, which consists of about 12 million base pairs. The scientists are making changes, such as deleting stretches of DNA that do not have any function, in an attempt to make a more streamlined and stable genome. But the human genome is more than 200 times as large as that of yeast, and it is not clear if such a synthesis would be feasible. Jeremy Minshall, chief executive of DNA2.0, a DNA synthesis company, questioned if the effort would be worth it. Our ability to understand what to build is so far behind what we can build, said Dr. Minshall, who was invited to the meeting at Harvard but did not attend. I just don't think that being able to make more and more and more and cheaper and cheaper and cheaper is going to get us the understanding we need. Exactly. Okay, well that's it. I thought there was more, but okay. I think that's the whole article. So, here are the comments that were made about this article. It's only a snapshot, obviously, because I'm sure people are still commenting to this very day. Nathan Adelson of San Francisco said, Don't think we're going to have to wait 20 years to get the price for a big custom genome down to $100,000, and probably in a few years it'll be down to $1,000. That's what Ray Kurzweil meant by the acceleration of science and technology. The singularity is near, and I'm looking forward to it. Unbelievable. Carl R. Lunder said, It's impossible for this not to happen. It is like handing pocket calculators to traders in a market and wondering where they were using. It is good that people who have been involved with DNA for a while, e.g. Dr. Church, are pushing this, rather than waiting for starry-eyed and inexperienced outsiders to take the lead. There is not necessarily a problem with respect to faith. There are some interesting Islamic discussions on cloning. The soundbite summary is that all of nature was divinely prepared for humans to work with, and therefore, okay, therefore with some restrictions it can be okay. Really? Where does he get that idea from? Unbelievable, these things these people say. Killjoy, 616 of USA, said, Yes, please, it's time to move on and push science as far as we can take it. It's not like you can bottle back the genie, no matter what some might think or make believe. We won't know what we can accomplish unless we try, and it's not like most of the human population is smart enough to understand this science when they are praying for rain. Oh, what a conceited, arrogant person, eh? Bob NV said, so they want to make a super race. Cool. We would go the way of early man. We are dead. Not if God has anything to do with it. Jeff in DC said, what they're suggesting could potentially affect our species. They don't have the right to do this type of experimenting. And Dutch in Chicago said, sorry, but I think we have to be quite a bit smarter and more grown up than we are to begin messing with the human genome on this level. Yes, I know that someone is going to attempt it, so why not Americans? But humanity has already proven it can't properly control a gun or a knife, not to mention NBC weapons. Why do we think we're responsible enough to control something even more potentially deadly? Sam Sarda West said, America's become a nation of secrets in which ordinary citizens have no idea what their government is doing behind the scenes, what corporations are doing, and what scientists, including those developing for the Pentagon, are doing. How long can democracy survive in such a climate? Well, democracy is a construct anyway, if people did but realise it. Ehud Frank of Israel said, if something can happen, it will. If anything wrong can happen, it will. This is the beginning of the end. Someday, sometime, hopefully, not in our lifetime. Hello, mankind, as we know it. Strong Mind in Chicago said, I think the secret meeting was on how to get some of that climate change research money. And Dolly Patterson of Redwood City, California said, I've been hearing these stories for 20 years and I'm sick of the sensation about them. Yes, I worked my tail end off for some stem cell research to pass California Proposition 71 and followed the research around Dolly the Sheep while working at Stanford University's Medical Center. I get it. It's exciting. But there's always a balance of good and bad. I don't think the world would have needed the bigotry it had all these years if people understood genetics. Heck, we wouldn't have the transgender bathroom fights today if people understood genetics. Oh dear, I just loved it, innit? But can the media please stop projecting and making these stories so dramatic and sensational? The media is not helping human health and welfare when they print these types of futurist and science fiction stories. Remember how evil Republicans thought stem cell research was? Yeah, and it still is. Hadshi Halef Omar on the Orient Express said two things. First, we're not nearly there yet. The entire human genome has been cloned in bacteria and been available in a dish for over 30 years. That's not the point. The challenge, for which I do not read answer here or anywhere in the literature, is how the DNA can be repackaged into functional chromosomes, in vitro, endowed with the proper methylation pattern, and with the proper histone modifications in place that are required for driving even the early stages of embryonic development. After that, those chromosomes must be transferred back into oocyte that has undergone fertilization, packaged into the nucleus, in the context of a functional spindle apparatus to allow the first cell division. CRISPR, the technology we all have heard so much about for the last year or so, is child's play compared to that. Second, even if we could do all that, making changes to the genome in a way where we could predict the outcome is equally difficult. Knowing the coding sequence is one thing, but we have absolutely no idea how all the regulatory regions, which really determine how the person coming out of this is shaping up, are interacting with each other. Right now, it is completely unclear how these problems can or will be solved. A much safer bet is that we can have bases on Mars in 30 years. That is technologically possible, but I still doubt it will happen. I hope many of you will sleep better tonight after reading this. Malcolm in New York City said, scary territory. When it is not if, but when. We are capable of artificially synthesizing a human genome. Then what kind of choices will we, or rather they, make? Based on what goals, desires, principles, science? Would it be a new master race with all the intelligence and good looks and bodies that we all envy? If so, we may be creating a group of dangerous narcissists on a scale that even we in the US are unused to, and that includes Donald Trump. That is just one of many outcomes that may ensue. It seems to me that we lack the wisdom to use this new technology, but given who we are, we will of course use it. Yeah. El Muador of New York City said, I am reminded of the Pinky and Brain popular 90s cartoon series depicting mice trying to take over the world. We haven't fully sequenced the human genome, and the unsequenced islands, full of repeats and difficult, impossible to assemble stretches of DNA, are legion. Furthermore, new genes pop up wherever we go, including in mitochondria, where they just found a novel, if small, protein in a 16 kilobyte genome. That's sure. We haven't got a clue what about 50% of the sequenced genes are doing. How they are regulated, what pathways, path nets there are. Big data on a small subject doesn't mean big understanding. I'm afraid, I'm sure we know most about P53 now, and how and which bases you methylate, glycosylate, etc. of the chemically made DNA before you put it in a cell like environment. Absurd, but cute. Laboratory mice, their genes have been spliced. Synthesizing DNA has been done since the late 60s, and nobody got their ethics panties in a bunch. We'll cross that bridge when we get there, shall we? Yeah. Iggy B. of Georgia said, this will happen eventually. Why do some people, given the track record of human history, believe it will mostly result in good things? Ultimately, this is about contempt for nature and elevating individuals into positions of a god. They will say people like myself are against curing cancer, that they simply want to rid humanity of terrible diseases and abnormalities. But they meet in secret because deep down they know in some corner of their brain where this will go. It isn't hard to guess. Look what we've done in the past. In some East Asian nations, they have a demographic problem because of the disproportionate number of female fetuses that get aborted. In South Korea, it has been illegal to tell the mother what gender the baby will be, but the law is broken so often the number of male fetuses allowed to live is lopsided to the detriment of future generations. This is the most likely type of outcome we're going to get as our ability to overrule nature increases. We don't have to guess at the future because we have a clear track record of what we already do and have done before. I hope I'm dead before they gain the power to mass-produce humans. Once the cord of fathering and mothering a child is severed and humans are produced based on design, humanity will become extinct. We'll be a different species then, and I wish those who believe that will be a good thing would try to explain why, based on our track record so far in recorded history. Yeah, that's about the only voice of sanity in this in these comment sections. Of course, here we go. Killjoy616A chimes back in with, turn off your computer and go ride a horse if you think technology leads to bad things. No, ignorance and the groupthink of peasants leads to bad outcomes. It's amazing, isn't it? CC in Europe said, I think that my two freedom-craving teenage boys would have loved to have been the first human beings witnessed, beings without biological parents. And concerned citizen of Anywheresville said, I can't imagine any possible way that this could go horribly, horribly wrong. Can you? And to which EJ Huff of Laurel Highland says, nope. And then he says, okay, folks, this is not about creating a human embryo and implanting it. It is about creating an immortal cell line to be grown in cell culture. There are many human cell lines. The first, known as HeLa, was derived from cervical cancer cells, taken on February 8, 1951, from Henrietta Lacks, a patient who died of her cancer on October 4, 1951. And he says, see Wikipedia about that. Rajiv Vaya of Phoenix, Arizona said, what will happen to regular humanity when the brave new world of Homo sapiens syntheticus arrives? What will these post-humans do to us? Most likely we will share the Neanderthals' fate. Hopefully, Earth will have far better stewards. See, they still believe all that thing about, primitive man, and then, advanced man came along and wiped out primitive man. Absolute rubbish. Still, what does God's word say, isn't it? They would prefer to believe a lie than the simple truth that is in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Here we go. Killjoy comes back with, it would not matter because you will not be around. It's like saying what will happen to humans in a million years. Get over the fear of new things. Fred Carceres of Wallingford, Philadelphia said, I know it sounds exciting to see what we can do, but it also sounds cruel. Creating humans to use them as soldiers sounds like slavery to me. It is wrong, and that cannot be allowed. I oppose 1,000% it is inhuman. He's right, it is. Ashland in Cincinnati said, once they create the DNA, they can ask James Brown for some soul and incorporate it and make an atheist, maybe Obama. Remember, these scientists will not be able to steal a monkey's DNA and convert it into Sharpton because monkeys don't have a soul. There you go. Yeah. Oh, so monkeys don't have a soul, do they? Right. As if he knows. Wolfman in Milord in Michigan said, if it can be done, it will be done. Right or wrong, good or bad, it makes no difference. Sarah in Oakland, California said, just as the AI zealots misunderstand the nature of human consciousness, these gene wonks misunderstand what makes us human. These reductionists apparently don't know what they can't feel. The full, mysterious array of subjective experience, woven through time, resonant with events, feelings, relationships, art, music, travel, loss, love, nightmares, joy, transcendence, sensuality, memory, intersubjectivity. So their science projects become enthralling and preposterous. Men, mostly, have wanted to challenge the power of creation, be it imagined through God or through a woman's uterus. They strive to defy their own limitations. They claim they'll recreate Einstein, but that is a rationalization. The giddy delusions of arrogant tech boys, hubris and chutzpah. Here we go. Here comes Killjoy 616 again. No gods were needed for life to start, and no gods will be needed for humanity to move into the future. Yeah, right. I'll just retort with, foolish is the man who says in his heart there is no God. Peter Germantown of Maryland says, scientists abandoned ethics long ago when declaring that while the species is important, the individual is not. I wonder if humanity's undoing will happen in my lifetime. I have no doubt it will happen. Here comes Killjoy again. Don't be ignorant. The individual has never been important when it came to religion, government, or for that matter, anything. Societies have not even recognized the individual to fiction. Individual matter to themselves, but the group comes first when it comes to survival. Robert Cohen of Atlanta, Athens, Georgia said, these are some brave new world first thoughts, and after I post my reactions, then I'll look at comments, because there are usually both pro and dissenting minds of various perspectives hereafter. The phenomena shall probably become so controversial they'll be protested and suppressed. But researchers will find ways to pursue their fantastic work, whether domestically, secretly, or offshore. I presume researching is ongoing, at least privately in the real world now. This research will seemingly go on, whatever local, national, and or internal laws apply. It surely makes no difference what I think is right or wrong, and especially because I can't decide what's good or bad anyhow. Yeah, that's it. Just going back to God's word again, isn't it? My people are destroyed through lack of knowledge. Citizen of Maryland said, this would have been a far more interesting article if it had spent some time comparing this conference with the December conference on gene editing held in Washington, D.C., which focused specifically on the moral and ethical implications of gene editing technologies. As it is, this article makes it sound as though all the gene scientists want to forge ahead in secrecy, making some sort of Frankenstein monster without any thought of the consequences. The December conference makes it clear that it is simply not the case at all. Did the reporter write up this conference even attend the December one? Lots of reporters did, after all. Yeah, well, you know, we all, walked to a different drum, and I guess this reporter felt that he had to, and I don't think he sensationalised it much, do you people? You know, but I think he just had to try and draw attention to the fact that, you know, this is what's going on behind closed doors. And, never mind the ethical debates, you know. So, that's that subject out of the way. And I want to share something with you. It's probably going to be hard to read because it said that there was highlighted parts, but I think I'll just read through it and, you know, hopefully you'll get the gist of what I'm talking about. So, further to my last week's post about why Ukraine Christians should vote Brexit, it's interesting to think that the government of my country has actually committed treason, and it goes right way back to that politician who the rhyme that came out was, "He yachts while Britain rots." And I was thinking about it when I was reading this letter, and I thought to myself, yeah, did Genesis, or did the members of Genesis know something when they wrote an album and called it Selling England by the Pound? Because I find that quite intriguing now, and I was wondering, well, you see, because I'm starting to realise that quite a lot of the musicians have Masonic connections, so, you know, they are privy to what's going on behind closed doors. So I thought to myself, was they indirectly, like, letting their audience know that, yeah, you know, this is what's happening? You know, but of course, people just say, oh, great music. They don't, you know, I mean, see, that's what I've always gone through life. I've always taken to heed the lyrics in songs because I've found that sometimes they've been very, very revealing. You know, right through my whole life, you know, I've found some very, very, you know, sometimes it's been, you know, the human drama of how someone has been unjustly treated. I mean, as I speak, the Bob Dylan song Hurricane comes to mind, you know, where he actually exposed the travesty that was of justice against you know, the boxer, and which was no doubt a racist, you know, had racist tendencies. Anyway, let's look at this. So this is, as it says, this is a damning letter from Lord Kilmure, who was the Lord Chancellor to Edward Heath. Now, this is a website where actually it is encouraged that you sign a petition to, you know, to actually get this exposed. I mean, I personally have signed it, and I would hope that all other UK Christians who get to see this post would do likewise, because we do have to stand up and say no. So, as it says, in an answer to a letter from Edward Heath, written on the 30th November, I don't know when this was, it's probably been in the 70s at some time, Lord Kilmure, the Lord Chancellor, makes it plain that there are real problems with the constitutional limitations imposed on government which prevent our joining the EEC. He goes on to mention some ways in which the Constitution will conflict with Heath's plans, but also indicate ways of subverting the conflict. The comments in red, I'm sorry, but I don't know which ones are, I'll just read all the way through, interleaved in Lord Kilmure's letter, clearly show that the Heath's government was prepared to commit acts of sedition and treason in taking the UK into the EEC. Unfortunately, we do not have a copy of Heath's original letter to Lord Kilmure, and therefore Heath's questions are unknown. However, it will take little imagination to guess what they were. And I quote Lord Kilmure, "My dear Ted, you wrote to me on the 30th of November about the constitutional implications of our becoming a party to the Treaty of Rome. I have now had an opportunity of considering what you say in your letter, and have studied the memoranda you sent me. I agree with you that there are important constitutional issues involved. I have no doubt that if we do sign the treaty, we shall suffer some loss of sovereignty. But before attempting to define or evaluate the loss, I wish to make one general observation. At the end of the day, the issue whether or not to join the European Economic Community must be decided on broad political grounds, and if it appears from what..." Excuse me as I scroll. So I'm losing my place as I'm scrolling up. So I might have to repeat myself here. "I have no doubt that if we do sign the treaty, we shall suffer some loss of sovereignty. But before attempting to define or evaluate the loss, I wish to make one general observation. At the end of the day, the issue whether or not to join the European Economic Community must be decided on broad political grounds. And if it appears from what follows in this letter that I find the constitutional objections serious, that does not mean that I consider them conclusive. I do, however, think it important that we should appreciate clearly from the outset exactly what, from the constitutional point of view, is involved if we sign the treaty. And it is with that consideration in mind that I have addressed myself to the questions you have raised." I imagine this was the bit that was... You see, it says, "He is clear that if we do sign an agreement with the EEC, we will suffer some loss of sovereignty. This is clearly an act of treason, because our constitution allows no surrender of any part of our constitution to a foreign power beyond the control of the Queen in Parliament. This is evidenced by the convention, which says, Parliament may do many things, but what it may not do is surrender any of its rights to govern unless we have been defeated in war. And in the ruling given to King Edward III in 1366, in which he was told that King John's action in surrendering England to the Pope and ruling England as a vassal king to Rome was illegal because England did not belong to John, he only held it in trust for those who followed on. The money the Pope was demanding as tribute was not to be paid because England's kings were not vassal kings to the Pope, and the money was not owed. Adherence to the Treaty of Rome would, in my opinion," going back to, obviously this is going back to Lord Kilmure's letter, he says, "adherence to the Treaty of Rome would, in my opinion, affect our sovereignty in three ways. Parliament would be required to surrender some of its functions to the organs of the community." And then he says, answers above. He says, "The Crown would be called on to transfer part of its treaty-making power to those organs of the community. The Constitution confers treaty-making powers only on the Sovereign, and the Sovereign cannot transfer those powers to a foreign power or even our own Parliament, because they are not the incumbent Sovereigns to give away. as they only hold those powers in trust for those who follow on. Our courts of law would sacrifice some degree of independence by becoming subordinate in certain respects to the European Court of Justice. It is a praemunire to allow any case to be taken to a foreign court not under the control of the sovereign. The European Court of Justice or the European Court of Human Rights are foreign courts, not under the control of our sovereign praemunire, and is a crime akin to treason. The position of Parliament. It is clear that a memorandum prepared by your legal advisers that the Council could eventually, after the system of qualified majority voting had come into force, make regulations which would be binding on us, even against our wishes, and which would in fact become for us part of the law of the land. There are two ways in which this requirement of the treaty could in practice be implemented. It is a praemunire to allow any laws or regulations not made by the sovereign in Parliament to take effect as law in England. This is illegal under the Acts of Treason of 1351, the Act of Praemunire of 1392, and the Act of Supremacy of 1559, and the Declaration and Bill of Rights of 1688 to 1689. Parliament could legislate ad hoc on each occasion that the Council make regulations requiring action by us. The difficulty would be that, since Parliament can bind neither itself nor its successors, we could only comply with our obligations under the treaty if Parliament abandoned its right of passing independent judgment on the legislative proposals put before it. A parallel is the Constitutional Convention whereby Parliament passes British North American bills without question at the request of the Parliament of Canada. In this respect, Parliament here has substance, if not in form, abdicated its sovereign position, and it would have pro tanto to do the same for the community. No such power exists for Parliament to do this. This would be an act of treason under the 1351 Treason Act, a praemunire under the 1392 Act of Praemunire, an act of treason under the 1559 Act of Supremacy, and the 1688-89 Declaration and Bill of Rights. It would in theory be possible for Parliament to enact at the outset legislation which would give automatic force of law to any existing or future regulations made by the appropriate organs of the community. For Parliament to do this would go far beyond the most extensive delegation of powers, even in wartime, that we have ever experienced, and I do not think there is any likelihood of this being acceptable to the House of Commons. Whichever course were adopted, Parliament would retain, in theory, the liberty to repeal the relevant act or acts. But I would agree with you that we must act on assumption that entry into the community would be irrevocable. We should therefore accept a position where Parliament had no more power to repeal us own enactments that it has in a practice to abrogate the Statute of Westminster. In short, Parliament would have to transfer to the Council or other appropriate organs of the community its substantive powers of legislating over the whole of a very important field. There is no constitutionally acceptable method of doing this, because it would be tantamount to a total abrogation of their duty to govern us according to our laws and customs, and it would be an act of treason under the 1351 Treason Act, a praemunire under the 1392 Act of Praemunire, and treason under the 1559 Act of Supremacy and a Declaration and Bill of Rights of 1688-89. The proposition that every treaty entered into by the United Kingdom does to some extent fetter our freedom of action is plainly true. Some treaties, such as GATT and OEEC, restrict severely our liberty to make agreements with third parties, and I should not regard it as detrimental to our sovereign that, by signing the Treaty of Rome, we undertook not to make tariff or trade agreements without the Council's approval. But to transfer to the Council or the Commission the power to make such treaties on our behalf, and even against our will, is an entirely different proposition. There seems to me to be a clear distinction between the exercise of sovereignty involved in the conscious acceptance by us of obligations under treaty-making powers and the total or partial surrender of sovereignty involved in our cessation of these powers to some other body. To confer a sovereign state's treaty-making powers on internationalisation is the first step on the road which leads, by way of confederation, to the fully federal state. I do not suggest that what is involved would necessarily carry us very far in this direction, but it would be a most significant step, and one for which there is no precedent in our case. Moreover, a further surrender of sovereignty, of parliamentary supremacy, would necessarily be involved, As you know, although the treaty-making power is vested in the Crown, parliamentary sanction is required for any treaty which involves a change in the law or the imposition of taxation, to take two examples, and we cannot ratify such a treaty unless Parliament consents. But if binding treaties are to be entered into on our behalf, Parliament must surrender this function and either resign itself to becoming a rubber stamp or give the community, in effect, the power to amend our domestic laws. This is a surrender of our sovereignty, a clear act of treason under the 1351 Treason Act and a praemunire under the 1392 Act of Praemunire. It is treason under the 1559 Act of Supremacy and the 1688 Declaration of Bill of Rights. There is no precedent for our final appellation tribunal being required to refer questions of law, even in a limited field, to another court, and as I assume to be the implication of refer, to accept that court's decision. You will remember that when a similar proposal was considered in connection with the Council of Europe, we felt strong objection to it. I have no doubt that the whole of the legal profession in this country would share my dislike for such a proposal, which must inevitably detract from the independence and authority of our courts. Of those three objections, the first two are by far the more important. I must emphasise that, in my view, the surrenders of sovereignty involved are serious ones, and I think that, as a matter of practical politics, it will not be easy to persuade Parliament or the public to accept them. I'm sure that it would be a great mistake to underestimate the force of objections to them, but these objections ought to be brought out into the open now, because if we attempt to gloss over them at this stage, those who are opposed to the whole idea of our joining the community will certainly seize on them, with more damaging effect later on. Having said this, I would emphasise once again that although those constitutional considerations must be given their full weight, when we come to balance the arguments on either side, I do not for one moment wish to convey the impression that they must necessarily tip the scale. In the long run, we shall have to decide whether economic factors require us to make some sacrifices of sovereignty. My concern is to ensure sovereignty, is to ensure that we should see exactly what it is that we are being called on to sacrifice, and how serious our loss would be. It is a praemunire to subject Her Majesty's courts of law to the domination of a foreign court outside of Her Majesty's control. So there you go. And I find it interesting, I was reading that obviously Lord Cumminier, he was sort of like, you know, pointing out the fact about the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and everything like, but then he was like, in a very sort of crafty way, trying to say, well, if we can actually get around this, you know. So, you know, this is how they operate. But whilst on the subject, you may recall last post I obviously gave you links to the Christian Voice thing, and he's got a new video out, and what a revelation. Like, this Treaty of Rome thing, you know where it was signed? It was signed in a building in Rome which was built around the pagan temple of Jupiter. And who was who was Jupiter? The Roman personification of the Greek god Zeus. And who is Zeus? Well, according to classic Greek literature, the father of gods, but we know him as Satan, because remember that the altar, or the which is called the seat of Satan at Pergamos, was the altar of Zeus. So here we had the Roman version of it in Rome, you know, and they just built around the altar, built the new building. It's actually a museum there and everything like that. But, you know, so basically, you know, calling out to all you UK Christians, yeah, you know, this is serious. This shows you that the whole treaty, all the Treaty of Rome, and all the things pertaining to the European Union were signed on the altar of Satan. So that tells you who these people worship, who these people are serving, and, you know, who they're hoodwinking, and I'll use that term because that is a Mason's term, yeah, the public into, you know, like we saw here, you know, with this thing with this discussion between Lord Kilmure and Edward Heath, you know, that they knew they were committing treason, yeah, but if they could keep the public dumbed down, keep the public ignorant, you know, because remember that, you know, I'm sure, you know, some of you will remember, like, how we were told that, you know, oh, it's just a trade agreement, you know, it's just going to be good for British businesses, you know, that's why we're entering into the common market, as they called it, you know. See, we were told it was just a trade thing, never knew that it was going to be an actual, you know, political, and you know, in some cases one would even say, you know, a religious dominion. You know, I mean, they have a flag. I mean, they're working on an army. You know, so words fail me, but anyway, you know, I've shared with you, and it's up to you what you want to do with it. You know, pass it on, I think, is the best thing. So, the subject of this was going to be nothing is as it seems. So you were seeing there an examples of. But let's go back to history a little bit, and then that's going to lead up to. Excuse me, while I move my camera. I think I'll move it out of here, actually. Put myself in a corner there. An interesting question, actually. And something that most people always see, you know, that World War II was us against the evil Nazis and so on, like, you know, and that the Antichrist Hitler and so on, like, you know. But, you know, as I'm starting to learn, you know, well, who financed him, yeah? How did he manage to build up a country which was totally devastated after World War I? Yeah, you know, and then, and remember, you know, what about the, what's his name? You know, the Wall Street crash and so on, like, and the Depression. How was it that Germany was able to, you know, thrive on that as well? Yeah? But anyway, so the, as I bring it up, the question it asked, and I think it's quite interesting, because people should stop this idea that when you speak against Jews that you're talking, that you're being anti-Semitic. No, you know, the Bible is quite clear about, you know, when Jesus says, I know those who I say, going here. Sorry about that. I've just cut myself off, haven't I? I don't know if you can still see me. Oh, it's come up. Oh, no, interesting as well. It said, oh, that was a terrible error. Anyway, now I'm going to try and move this over. Bear with me. Right. Now let's see how I can somehow reduce this down in size. That's the only problem with these things. Yeah. It's the blasted window that is the problem. That's a bit difficult to see. That's too high. Let's gradually. Sorry about this. Sorry about the pausing, but I'm trying to work it out. I can make this. Oh well, I'll take it up just a touch. Yeah, hopefully, I can read this. So this is the question, and this is the thing we should ask ourselves: were Hitler and Nazism Zionist creations? Yeah. Here's some quotes around the at certain times during the war. Yeah. Rabbi Felix Mendelssohn said in the Chicago Sentinel on October 8, 1942, the Second World War is being fought for the defense of the fundamentals of Judaism. Yeah. And Joseph Berg, who was an anti-Zionist Jew, said World War II was a Zionist plot to make way for the foundation of a Jewish state in Palestine. Yeah, that sounds more like it, doesn't it? Lloyd George said in the New York Journal American on June 24th of 1924, the Treaty of Versailles was hijacked by Jewish international financiers to create the necessary economic, social and political and conditions necessary for Hitler to exploit. And what does the Protocols of Zion say that most people say, oh, that's just imagine, that doesn't really exist, yeah? It is from us that all engulfing terror proceeds. We have in our service persons of all opinions, of all doctrines, monarchists, demagogues, socialists, communists, and utopian dreamers of every kind, striving to overthrow all established forms of order. All states are in torture, but we will not give them peace until they openly acknowledge our international supergovernment. New World Order. There it is. Society resembles a satanic cult in many ways. One is that the rank and file is not privy to the real satanic hidden agenda. Only the initiators are let in on the secret and allowed to advance. Similarly, every institution and grouping within society follows this model. Thus, ordinary Jews and Freemasons are easily manipulated and sacrifices necessary for the greater evil. As he says, I believe the Nazis were run by Sabbatian Jews or Kabbalists, but I don't agree that Rosenberg and Heydrich were among them. Rosenberg's The Track of the Jews Through the Ages is one of the best books on Jewish history written. Heydrich was murdered because he was sincere. The Nazi Party was set up, financed and maintained by Jewish international financiers. Once Hitler was safely elected, the Bank of England offered credit to Germany, and after the Nazis successfully invaded Czechoslovakia, it released 6 million of Czechoslovakian gold to Hitler, which was deposited in London. When you accept the proven involvement of Jewish bankers and their political representatives have been very involved in the funding of the Nazis' rearmament, you have only two possible answers. Either Zionists are not Jews, or the Zionists wanted a mass persecution of their own people. Both these answers are true. Many Zionists are not Jewish. Those that were knew that to further the rise and creation of the Zionist state in Palestine, they required an irrefutable need. The gathering Nazi hatred and blame towards the Jewish people for the ills of the world which led to the mass persecution gave the Zionist elite exactly that. Ernst Hanstegel, a close friend of Franklin Roosevelt, was also a close associate of Hitler before the war. He says he was warned by the Austrian writer Rudolf Kommer that if any political party emerges with anti-Semitic program directed by Jewish or half-Jewish fanatics, we shall have to watch out. Hanstegel wrote that later, after experiencing the influence that Alfred Rosenberg had on Hitler, he began to realise what that remark really meant. I thought back to Rudolf Kommer's remark about an anti-Semitic program directed by Jewish or half-Jewish fanatics. Rosenberg was distinctly Jewish in appearance, although he would have been the first to protest furiously if anyone had questioned his ancestry. Yet I used to see him most mornings sitting in a dingy cafe at the corner of Breinerstrasse and Augustenstrasse with a Hungarian Jew named Holoschki, who was one of his principal assistants. The man called himself Holland in Germany and was another of these Jewish anti-Semites. I suspected the Aryan background of many of the others. Strasser and Stryker looked Jewish to me, as well as figures like Ley and Frank and even Goebbels, who would have difficulty improving their pedigree. So the creation of hatred towards the Jewish race, then the grotesque treatment that followed Hitler's decrees, was hyped to enormous proportions to justify the takeover of Palestine for a Jewish homeland. No one used this method more than Lord Victor Rothschild in his House of Lords speeches urging support for a Jewish state in Palestine. You can see the play by the elite clearly there. To add further to this, Hitler's book Mein Kampf was ghostwritten by Major General Karl Haushofer, who acknowledged that a major source for the ideas it expressed came from Halford J. Mackinder, a director of the elite's London School of Economics. There you go, the Fabians. Who would have thought it, eh? Hitler, a conscious puppet? To what degree was Hitler aware of his puppet status? Was he a willing or unwilling pawn in this Zionist-engineered heinous conflict? Hitler, like many leaders of today, was surrounded by a Zionist cabal. Heydrich, Goebbels, Rosenberg, Stryker and Eichmann. The Jews wanted a prolonged and devastating Second World War, which would eclipse the carnage and destruction of World War I. There was not nearly enough gold in existence to provide the loan capital needed to finance the war machine required in Germany and America to fund the wartime economy for those nations. So the Jews taught Hitler, through Feder, how to make his own money, how to circulate it, and how to engage in international trade without throwing out all of Germany's growth into the slop bucket of Jewish usury, nor let the Jews intervene in international trade and harvest the wealth of German production as middlemen. In this way, the Jews, who also poured money directly into Germany, financed Hitler in order to ultimately destroy Germany and much of Europe through Jewish manufactured war. They had done the same with their agent Napoleon Bonaparte, who considered himself to be the Jews' messiah, who tried to take Palestine for the Jews, who emancipated the Jews, and who was rewarded by the Jews with prison as punishment for promoting good Gentile-Jewish relations, which led to Jewish assimilation, the Jews' most hated enemy. Zionists welcomed the Nazi anti-Semitic politics. Like the Nazis, they believed in race-based national character and destiny. Like the Nazis, they believed Jews had no future in Germany. The cooperation extended to political and economic spheres. Adolf Eichmann set up agricultural training camps in Austria to prepare young Jews for kibbutz life. He visited Palestine and conferred with Zionist leaders who confessed their true expansionist goals. Think about it. Hitler could have just confiscated all the Jewish wealth. Instead, he used the Havara program to help establish the State of Israel. On November 25, 1940, a boat carrying Jewish refugees from Nazi Europe, the Patria, exploded and sank off the coast of Palestine, killing 252 people. The Zionist Haganah claimed the passengers committed suicide to protest British refusal to let them land. Years later, admitted that rather than let the passengers go to Mauritius, it blew up the vessel. Sometimes it's necessary to sacrifice the few in order to save the many, quoting Moshe Sharet, a former Israeli prime minister, which was said at a memorial service in 1958. Jack Bernstein, in his book An American Jew in Racist Marxist Israel, stated, "The Ashkenazi Jews who migrated to Israel from Germany, while sympathetic to communism and support it, tend to favour the practices of Nazi-style fascism. During World War II in Germany, these elite Zionist Ashkenazis Jews worked closely with Hitler's Gestapo in persecuting the lower-class German Jews and delivering them to concentration camps. Now living in Israel, these elite Zionist Jews, who were well-trained in Nazi-style fascism and favour it, have imposed many facets of fascism on Israel. To give the impression that Israel is a democracy, members of the Knesset, that's Israel's Congress, are elected. But it's an odd kind of election. This is where Israel's so-called democracy stops. It doesn't make any difference which party wins an election, the Likud or Labour Party. The elite Zionist Jews rule in a dictatorial manner, giving favours to the elite clique and brutally suppressing any dissent. Concerning Nazism and fascism, please let me clear a point. Germans are an admirable people, I dare say even great, but in Germany the general population was victim of the Nazis who through cunning and brutality gained power. In Germany the average Jews were victims of the Zionist elite who worked hand in hand with the Nazis. Many of those same Zionist Jews who in Germany had worked with the Nazis came to Israel and joined hands with the Zionist communist Jews from Poland and Russia. It is the two faces of communism and Nazi-style fascism that rule Israel. Democracy is a mere illusion." So there you go. See, nothing is as it seems. And then coming up to more recent history, I'm going to share with you from an amazing book. It's called The War on Truth. And I highly recommend it. It will really open your eyes as to what really goes on in this wicked world. And there it is. It's by Ahmed Mosaddegh. Sorry, by NAFFEZ Mosaddegh Ahmed. Yeah. The subtitle being 9/11, Disinformation and the Anatomy of Terrorism. So today I'm going to share with you. How are we doing? We've just gone over the hour. Hopefully everyone's going to watch all this. Well, you know, what was it? Let them have eyes see and let them have ears hear. Okay. Yeah. Know your enemy. Yeah. So let's look at terrorism and statecraft. Now, my understanding of the word statecraft, it means that basically governments perform terrorist acts on their own people. For their own political ends, yeah, and usually it's done in order to keep the people in a constant state of fear, and also to justify their, you know, further draconian methods. You know, in America, it's the, what's the mantra? National security, and here in this country, it's safety and security. What does the Bible say about things? It says, wherever they declare peace and security, a certain destruction happens. Yeah, because you see. Only God can give us peace and security, not man. You know, why? Because man is infallible. Sorry, man is fallible, yeah? He makes mistakes, you know, overlooks things, you know. But the worst thing is that when some of these terrorist acts are actually committed by, you know, the government, yeah? In other words, you know, either financed or orchestrated, you know, we need to stop believing our government and start believing God. And start putting our trust in him and crying out to him. Yeah? So, according to a former CIA analyst cited by Labevier in his Dollars for Terror, the policy of guiding the evolution of Islam and of helping them against our adversaries worked marvellously well in Afghanistan against the Red Army. The same doctrines can still be used to destabilise what remains of Russian power and especially to counter the Chinese influence in Central Asia. In other words, the CIA had always seen vast potential to use the terrorist network established by bin Laden during the Cold War in an international framework in the post-Cold War era against Russian and Chinese power, for example in Eastern Europe, the Balkans and Central Asia. From the beginning of US policy in Afghanistan, the CIA had hoped that the network of terrorists being spawned by Osama bin Laden with assistance from Saudi Arabia and Pakistan would continue to be used after the Afghan war against Soviet occupation. Indeed, US intelligence maintained its cooperation of Al-Qaeda by proxy as a means of expanding US power in the Balkan Wars. The degree to which Al-Qaeda provides an often convenient, if highly dangerous, instrument of Western statecraft for the orchestration of illegal and corrupt covert operations can be understood in this context. In the cases that will be discussed, Al-Qaeda is shown to be not a enemy, inverted commas, to be fought and eliminated, but rather an unpredictable intelligence asset to be controlled, manipulated and co-opted as much as possible to secure covert strategic ends. Lebevier's book, with meticulous documentation, places all this in the context of an ongoing US policy that aims to selectively foster so-called Islamic militancy to secure various strategic and economic interests around the world. Lebevier documents a so-called short-sighted policy that at first did not anticipate the degree to which Al-Qaeda would turn against the US, but even after reaping the bloody fruits of its own policy, continued to signal a green light to its allies, funneling finances and arms to Al-Qaeda. The maintenance of such a green light seems based on the calculation that the policy would ultimately suit US interests far better than the alternative option. In other words, pursuing meaningful measures to crack down on bin Laden's network, including intense pressure on its own regional allies. Al-Qaeda, he reports, was protected because the network was designed to serve US foreign policy and military interests. He adds that US diplomacy is in the habit of using religious movements against communism and any other obstacle to its hegemonic objectives. After the collapse of the Soviet Empire, this policy persisted without any major setback until the Gulf War. Mainly intended to safeguard the American oil supply, that police action caused a great trauma in the Arab Muslim world. Armed Islamism then started to question the guidance of its protective father. Shortly after the Gulf War, armed Islamism turned against its principal creator, who, in spite of all, did not give up his paternalistic reflex. Indeed, although in the uncomfortable position of the attacker attacked, the United States still continues unabated its policy of supporting the multifarious explosion of an ascendant Islamism. Its terrorist excesses and its business networks that are extremely ramified, if not entirely melded, into the circuits of the legal economy. US policy in the Balkans provides a surprising confirmation of Lebevier's thesis and provides a profoundly powerful explanation of how Western foreign policies directly undermine Western national security by forming alliances with the very forces of terror that are so threatening. Although this material is well documented, its crucial implications are largely ignored by the majority of academic and media commentators. Surprise, surprise. Well, why? Because they're in the pocket. You know, the media's in the government's pocket anyway, isn't it? Successive US administrations have used Al-Qaeda to pursue strategic interests in the Balkans. A further examination of this issue, however, reveals that the US Al-Qaeda alliance in the Balkans has been instrumental in facilitating successive terrorist attacks against US targets. Nevertheless, the alliance continues to exist to this day. As the London Spectator noted, America's role in backing the Mujahideen a second time in the early and mid-1990s is seldom mentioned. From 1992 to 1995, the Pentagon assisted with the movement of thousands of Mujahideen and other Islamic elements from Central Asia into Europe to fight alongside Bosnian Muslims against the Serbs. If Western intervention in Afghanistan created the Mujahideen, Western intervention in Bosnia appears to have globalized it. Much of the details of the alliance have been authoritatively documented in the official Dutch inquiry into the 1995 Srebrenica massacre, which contains an in-depth report on Western intelligence in the Bosnian conflict by Professor Cees Weebs of Amsterdam University. In a review of the Weebs report for the London Guardian, British political scientist Professor Richard Aldrich of the University of Nottingham described the Dutch's inquiry's most salient findings based on 5 years of unrestricted access to Dutch intelligence files and interviews with key officials. Now we have the full story of the secret alliance between the Pentagon and radical Islamic groups from the Middle East designed to assist the Bosnian Muslims. Some of the same groups that the Pentagon is now fighting in the war against so-called war, and I say so-called war because it is a so-called war against terrorism. Pentagon operations in Bosnia have delivered their own blowback. Sorry, I've had it. And that term blowback is another euphemism, as they call it. Just like collateral damage is another one, as you know. The policy created a vast secret conduit of weapons smuggling through Croatia and was in flagrant violation of the UN Security Council's arms embargo against all combatants in the former Yugoslavia. The conduit was arranged by the intelligence agencies of the US, Turkey and Iran, together with a range of radical Islamist groups, including Afghan Mujahideen. British intelligence services obtained documents on the secret alliance early on in the Bosnian War, but turned a blind eye. Aldrich continues. Arms purchased by Iran and Turkey with the financial backing of Saudi Arabia made their way by night from the Middle East. Initially, aircraft from Air Iran were used. But as the volume increased, they were joined by a mysterious fleet of black C-130 Hercules aircraft. The report stresses that the US was very closely involved in the airlift. Mujahideen fighters were also flown in, but they were reserved as shock troops for especially hazardous operations. Rather than the CIA, the Pentagon's own secret service was the hidden force behind these operations. American AWACS aircraft covered crucial areas and were able to turn a blind eye to the frequent nighttime comings and goings in Tuzla. The secret arms shipments from Iran began in 1992 and were first discovered by the CIA on September 4, 1992. An Iranian Boeing 747 was found at Zagreb Airport in Croatia, containing arms, ammunition, anti-tank rockets, communication equipment, uniforms and helmets for the Bosnian Muslim Army. Around 30,000 soldiers were armed and equipped by Iran and Turkey in 1 3- to 5-month period in late 1993 in this manner. US military intelligence at first tacitly consented to the conduit, but then later actively supported it. On April 27, 1994, President Clinton decided to give a green light to the arms supplies. Surprise, surprise. This secret US-backed conduit between Iran, Turkey, Saudi Arabia and the Bosnian Muslims was also used to fly in Al-Qaeda Mujahideen forces connected to Osama bin Laden from Afghanistan, Algeria, Chechnya, Yemen, Sudan and elsewhere. The US played a very direct role in facilitating this influx, according to one authority report from London's International Media Corporation affiliated to Washington DC, DC's International Strategic Studies Association. The Mujahideen landing at Plochi are reported to have been Mujahideen accompanied by US special forces equipped with high-tech communications equipment. Intelligence sources indicate that the mission of the US troops was to establish a command, control, communications and intelligence network to coordinate and support Bosnian Muslim offences in concert with Mujahideen and Bosnian Croat forces. The US military, in other words, was actively coordinating on the ground with several thousand members of bin Laden's Al-Qaeda network in Bosnia. Consequently, as estimated by US Lieutenant Colonel John Stray, who worked as an intelligence officer in Sarajevo in 1994, approximately 4,000 Mujahideen, supported by Iranian Special Operations Forces, have been continually intensifying their activities in central Bosnia for more than 2 years. According to Josip Bodanski, director of the Congressional Task Force on Terrorism and Unconventional Warfare, most reliable intelligence estimates indicate that the number of Al-Qaeda-affiliated Mujahideen operating in Bosnia at this time was more than 10,000. In a succinct overview of this policy, director of the Center for Research on Globalization, Professor Michael Chosadovsky of the University of Ottawa, finds that the evidence amply confirms that the CIA never severed its ties to the Islamic Militant Network, as it was called, since the end of the Cold War. These cover intelligence links have not only been maintained, they have in fact become increasingly sophisticated. According to the London-based International Media Corporation, for example, the US Central Intelligence Agency has full knowledge of the operation to fly in and equip hundreds of Mujahideen into Bosnia-Herzegovina. Indeed, the CIA believed that some of the 400 had been detached for future terrorist operations in Western Europe. Chosadovsky also refers to a lengthy congressional report by the Republican Party Committee in 1997, confirming that the Clinton administration helped turn Bosnia into a militant Islamic base. Among the radical groups involved in the scheme was one Sudan-based humanitarian organization called the Third World Relief Agency, which was a major link in the arms pipeline to Bosnia. This agency, however, was reportedly connected with such fixtures of the Islamic terror network as Sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman, the convicted mastermind behind the 1993 World Trade Center bombing, and Osama bin Laden, a wealthy Saudi emigre believed to bankroll numerous militant groups. In other words, the US Al-Qaeda alliance in Bosnia seems to have played a key role in preventing US action to apprehend the mastermind of the first World Trade Center bombings in 1993, Sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman, otherwise known as the Blind Sheikh, before the attack occurred. The Blind Sheikh was utilized by the CIA in the Afghan war against the Soviets due to his influence over the Mujahideen. Having arrived in the US on a CIA-sponsored visa, he was described by US intelligence officials as a valuable asset. He had been a close companion of Osama bin Laden during the war against the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan. As Newsweek reported, the Sheikh had slipped into the United States with the protection of the CIA, which saw the revered cleric as a valuable recruiting agent for the Muj, or the Afghan Mujahideen. Investigators trying to track down the Blind Sheikh had zero cooperation from the intelligence community, zero, recalled a federal investigator in New York. US intelligence analyst Marianne Weaver observes the CIA and State Department overlooked his anti-Western message and incitement to holy war because they wanted him to help unify the Mujahideen groups. Yet the Blind Sheikh was one of the most outspoken advocates of jihad against the West, in particular against America, bridging his message freely throughout the 1980s in Pakistan, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Germany, England, and even the United States. Citing an investigative report by New York magazine, the Associated Press described how this relationship proceeded in some detail. The CIA sponsored Sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman's visits to jihad offices around the United States starting in 1986. The jihad, or holy war, offices were American outposts for the CIA, funded Mujahideen fighting the occupying Soviets. The war ended in 1989. Although Abdel Rahman's name should have been added to the State Department's list of terrorist suspects after he was acquitted in connection with the 1981 assassination of Egyptian President Anwar Sadat, that did not happen until 1987. Between 1986 and 1990, he received at least three visas to enter the United States. Eventually, he received permanent resident status. But Sheikh Omar's involvement in the Afghan war against the Soviets does not explain why he continued to gain entry into the US after that war had ended in 1989. The Associated Press noted that in 1990 a CIA officer serving at the US Embassy in Sudan approved Abdel Rahman's tourist visa. The State Department determined in 1993. The Blind Sheikh's green card was approved shortly after December, despite the fact that the State Department by November 1990 had actually revoked his visa, advising the INS to attempt to locate him, but evidently not to expel him. For once, the INS found him. It granted him a green card for permanent US residency. After the Afghan war was over, however, the Blind Sheikh remained a significant intelligence asset, playing an instrumental role in recruiting Mujahideen for Bosnia, at least as early as 1993, the year of the first World Trade Center terror attack. According to London's Compass magazine, the Al-Kifa, or Struggle, refugee center in New York, which used to recruit and raise funds for Mujahideen headed for Afghanistan, last year announced it was switching its operations to Bosnia. It was established in the mid-1980s by Egyptian Mustafa Rahman as a joint venture with Sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman, spiritual leader of Jamaat al-Islamiyah. But financial flows going through the same centre were being used to contribute funds for domestic terrorist attacks. As the New York Times reported, the World Trade Center bombing of 1993 was financed through money coming from the Al-Kifa Refugee Center in Brooklyn. Indeed, as late as the summer of 1993, Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak confirmed that Sheikh Rahman was connected to the CIA. The Blind Sheikh's central role in recruiting Mujahideen for the covert US-backed pipeline in Bosnia demonstrates his continuing importance to US intelligence agencies despite the demise of the Cold War, even though he was on the State Department's terrorism watch list. Meanwhile, he was masterminding the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center. For instance, when Al-Sayed Nasser, a leading member of the Blind Sheikh's Al-Salam Mosque, shot and killed radical right-wing Rabbi Meir Kahane in November of 1990, the FBI refused to investigate the Blind Sheikh's role in the murder due to his immunity as a CIA asset. The matter was revealed in a conversation between a 20-year veteran FBI agent and his top undercover operative. "Why aren't we going after the Sheikh?" meaning Abdel Rahman, demanded the undercover man. "It's hands off," answered the agent. "Why?" asked the operative. "It was no accident the Sheikh got a visa and that he's still in the country," replied the agent, visibly upset. "He's here under the banner of national security, the State Department, the NSA and the CIA. The agent pointed out that the Sheikh had been granted a tourist visa and later a green card, despite the fact he was on a State Department terrorist watch list that should have barred him from the country. "He's an untouchable," concluded the agent. The refusal to investigate the blind sheikh was maintained in spite of the fact that Nasser was being monitored by the FBI as a suspected terrorist, and that following the shooting of Rabbi Kahane, an FBI raid on El Said Nasser's accommodation discovered detailed documentation of the blind sheikh's World Trade Center bombing plot. William Norman Grigg reported in the New York in the New American that the FBI seized and impounded 49 boxes of documents from Nasser's New Jersey apartment. The case included bomb-making instructions, a hit list of public figures, including Kahane, parliamentary training materials, detailed pictures of famous buildings, including the World Trade Center, and sermons by Sheikh Omar urging his followers to destroy the edifices of capitalism. The Los Angeles Times similarly noted that the FBI had discovered manuals for building bombs. They found photos of the World Trade Center, the Empire State Building, and the Washington Monument, and a text advocating terrorist strikes on American soil. According to one senior investigator, the collection of documents amounted to a roadmap to the World Trade Center bombing plot, but they sat in an FBI locker, untranslated, in about 50 storage boxes. Only after the detonation of the bomb in the World Trade Center did the FBI finally open the boxes. Indeed, the key organizer of the 1993 World Trade Center bombing plot was an Egyptian intelligence officer, Emad Ali Salem, who was at that time a long-standing FBI informant paid over $2 million for his infiltration of the blind sheikh's Al-Qaeda cell. Salem was called in by the prosecution as a government witness in the trial of the conspirators. Throughout his surveillance of the blind sheikh's cell, long before the blast, on the February 26th, Salem had secretly tape-recorded more than 1,000 conversations at various meetings with the cell's members. Salem had worked with fellow FBI informant Mahmoud Zaki Zakari, who had infiltrated the sheikh's cell since January 10, 1990. Through their informants, the FBI knew every residence, office and meeting which occurred between the sheikh and his followers for a period of 3.5 years. Reporting on the release and discovery of the tapes, Newsday observed that the federal informant who allegedly foiled the plot to bomb the Holland Tunnel and the United Nations building secretly tape-recorded his conversation with federal prosecutors and agents. Imad Salem, the shadowy government informant who videotaped Muslim fundamentalists as they allegedly conspired to bomb a variety of city landmarks, made at least 40 audio tapes of his discussions with FBI and federal authorities, sources say. Law enforcement officials discovered the tapes last month while they were gathering items from Salem's apartment, sources say. Joyce London, lawyer for suspect Tariq Al-Hassan, called the tapes a goldmine because they will show jurors how the case was spawned and will possibly bolster an entrapment defence. It's going to lay out exactly how the deal was set up, what instructions he, Salem, was given, and how far he was told to go to ensure these people, she said, to ensnare these people. Prosecutors concede that the conversations may become a potent weapon for defence attorneys, damaging the informant's credibility and strengthening the defence's theory that the FBI instigated the plot. Defence lawyers have blasted away at the credibility of Salem, accusing him of entrapping suspects in a plot that the FBI engineered. Salem worked as an FBI informant before the World Trade Center bombing, and then was recruited to infiltrate the Muslim militant community after the February 26 explosion. According to defence lawyers for the eight Arabs accused of masterminding the plot, the tapes proved that FBI informant Salem was the pivotal orchestrator of the scheme. Salem was wired before, after and during every meeting. It is known that Salem was involved in initial discussions providing the safe houses in which bombs were allegedly manufactured, helped purchase the firearms and other materials that were to be used in the attacks. By mid-February, Salem had even managed the massive chemical bomb that would kill 6 and injure more than 1,000 at the Trade Center, brewed in barrels hidden in the Jersey City storage unit. As usual, the wired Salem reported the bombing's arrangements to his FBI handlers. Renowned defense attorney William Kunstler described the implications of the manuscripts of Salem's recorded conversations. I've read a lot of tapes by now, transcripts of the tapes which were just furnished to me today. Before I came here, I read some of them, and they are things like having him, Salem, say, "Well, I think we ought to bomb the George Washington Bridge. That's a very good target. It would make the commuters raise hell with this government of ours." And so then says conspirator Sadiq Ali, "Yeah?" Salim, "And I think so." And so on. So, "Ali? Yeah?" And so on. That's the way it goes virtually throughout these hundreds of pages of transcriptions. There are 150 hours of tapes. Indeed, in one of the post-attack recordings, a conversation between FBI informant Salem and his handler, FBI Special Agent John Antichev, reveals both Salem's and the Bureau's involvement in constructing the bomb that blew up the World Trade Center. FBI, basically nothing has changed. I'm just telling you for my own sake that nothing. That this isn't the salary, but you got paid regularly for good information. I mean, the expenses were a little bit out of the ordinary, and it was really questioned. Don't tell Nancy I told you this. That's Nancy Floyd, is another FBI agent who worked with Salem. Saying, well, I have to tell her, of course. FBI, well, then, if you have to, you have to. Saying, yeah, I mean, because the lady was being honest and I was being honest and everything was submitted with the sheets and now it's questionable. FBI, it's not questionable. It's like a little out of the ordinary. Saying, okay, I don't think it was. If that was what you guys think, fine. But I didn't think, I don't think that because we was start already build the bomb, which is went off in the World Trade Center. It was built by supervising supervision from the Bureau and the DA. And we was all informed about it and we knew what the bomb start to be built. By who? By your confidential informant. What a wonderful, great case. In a further extraordinary report, the New York Times revealed that the FBI had precise advance warning of the attack. Nevertheless, no action was taken against the blind Sheikh cell. Instead, FBI agents originally proposed a bizarre plan to thwart the bombing plot by replacing the explosive with a harmless powder. The informant was to have helped the plotters build a bomb and supply the fake powder, but the plan was called off by an FBI supervisor, and the FBI refused to act to prevent the bombing. On the tapes, Selden recalls the FBI planned on building the bomb with a phony powder and grabbing the people who was involved in it. But he said the powder scheme was cancelled and we didn't do that. Selden was also heard criticising FBI agents for ignoring his warnings of the World Trade Center bombing. You saw this bomb went off and you know what that we could avoid that. You get paid, guys, to prevent problems like this from happening. Why had the FBI failed to act on its first-hand evidence of the bombing plot by apprehending the blind Sheikh and his circle of plotters? The answer seems to be, as one FBI agent observed, that he was under the protection of the State Department, the NSA and the CIA. In other words, an untouchable. It was the blind Sheikh's status as a CIA asset vis-a-vis the Bosnian conflict that appears to be the primary reason he was granted effective immunity by US intelligence agencies, despite being implicated in criminal acts and terrorist plots. His involvement in a covert US operation to transfer Al-Qaeda militants to the Balkans in order to escalate the destabilization of Yugoslavia, granting free rein to pursue criminal and terrorist activities within the US, to the point that even after the bombing, high-level elements of the US government were extremely reluctant to prosecute him. Perhaps a fear of revealing the extent of post-Cold War US co-optation of Al-Qaeda. Jack Bloom, investigator for the Senate Foreign Relations Subcommittee, complained that one of the big problems here is that many aspects of the World Trade Center bombing were associated with the Mujahideen, and there are components of our government that are absolutely disinterested in following that path because it leads back to people we supported in the Afghan War, and, crucially, to people whom the government continue to support in the Bosnian War. US officials were well aware of the implications of their post-Cold War alliance with Al-Qaeda in the Balkans. They knew that one of bin Laden's top lieutenants was commanding a league of operatives in Bosnia, which, during the 1990s, had thus become a staging area and safe haven for Al-Qaeda. Nevertheless, a conscious decision was made to continue allowing the growth and activities of Al-Qaeda Mujahideen in Europe throughout the 1990s. Extensive military intelligence training and assistance were provided to the KLA during the Kosovo conflict in the late 1990s by both American and British forces. This training continued despite the fact that it was documented in a 1999 congressional report by the US Senate Republican Party Committee that the KLA is closely involved with the extensive Albanian crime network that extends throughout Europe and into North America, including allegations that a major portion of the KLA finances are derived from that network, mainly proceeds from drug trafficking and terrorist organizations motivated by the ideology of radical Islam, including assets of Iran and of the notorious Osama bin Laden, who has vowed a global terrorist war against Americans and American interests. Indeed, as early as 1998, the US State Department listed the KLA as a terrorist organization connected to Al-Qaeda. Other US intelligence reports prove that not only is the KLA funded from afar by Al-Qaeda, numerous KLA fighters are retrained in Al-Qaeda camps in Afghanistan and Albania, and numerous Al-Qaeda Mujahideen have joined the ranks of the KLA. The reports substantiate a link between bin Laden and the KLA, including a common staging area in Tropoje, Albania, a centre for Islamic terrorists. KLA-sponsored border crossings into Kosovo from Albania of hundreds of foreign fighters include veterans of the militant group Islamic Jihad from Bosnia, Chechnya and Afghanistan, carrying forged Macedonian Albanian passports. As Ralph Mushki, Assistant Director of Interpol's Criminal Intelligence Directorate, testified before Congress in December 2000, in 1998, the US State Department listed the KLA as a terrorist organization, indicating that it was financing its operations with money from the international heroin trade and loans from Islamic countries and individuals, among them allegedly Osama bin Laden. Mushke also confirmed that Osama bin Laden sent one of his top military commanders to Kosovo to lead an elite KLA unit during the Kosovo conflict. While much of the KLA's funds came from Osama bin Laden, as reported by Mushke, and while KLA fighters were trained in Al-Qaeda camps, US and British military intelligence personnel actively mingled with the Al-Qaeda-backed KLA, providing them further extensive training and assistance. The Sunday Times reported that since March 1999, American intelligence agents have admitted they helped to train the Kosovo Liberation Army before NATO's bombing of Yugoslavia. Say officers were developing ties with the KLA and giving American military training manuals and field advice on fighting the Yugoslav army and Serbian police under the cover of ceasefire monitors. The US military gave KLA commanders, including no doubt Osama's own military commander in Kosovo, satellite telephones and global positioning systems. KLA commanders also had the mobile phone number of General Wesley Clark, the NATO commander. The Herald also disclosed that both the UK and the US set up clandestine camps inside Albania to teach the KLA effective guerrilla tactics. Despite government denials on both sides of the Atlantic, SAS, that's British Special Forces, and US Delta Force instructors were used to train Kosovo volunteers in weapons handling, demolition and ambush techniques and basic organisation. Former Drugs Enforcement Administration undercover agent Michael Levine comments that US support for the KLA, which is effectively Al-Qaeda's arm in the Balkans, has had direct repercussions for the United States in terms of drugs and terrorism. Levine, a 26-year veteran of undercover work for four federal agencies and the recipient of many Justice and Treasury Department awards, including the International Narcotics Enforcement Officer Association's Octavio Gonzalez Award, observes that US policy in Kosovo was simply insane. My contacts within the DEA are quite frankly terrified, but there's not much they can do, say. There's not much they can say without risking their jobs. These guys are a network that's active on the streets of this country. They're the worst elements of society that you can imagine. And now, according to my sources in drug enforcement, they're politically protected. As Levine points out, the US armed and funded the worst elements of the Mujahideen in Afghanistan. Drug traffickers, arms smugglers, anti-American terrorists. We later paid the price when the World Trade Center was bombed, and we learned that some of those responsible have been trained by us. Now we're doing the same thing with the KLA. The same has been noted by Yusuf Budansky, director of the Congressional Anti-Terrorism Task Force, who also notes that the KLA and its Albanian mafia allies constitute a vital arm of Osama bin Laden's terrorist network within the US, providing broad financial and logistical support for operations. The role of the Albanian mafia, which is tightly connected to the KLA, is laundering money, providing technology, safe houses and other support to terrorists within this country. This isn't to say that the Albanians themselves would carry out the actual terrorist operations, but there are undoubtedly sleeper agents within the Albanian networks, and they can rely upon those networks to provide them with support. In any case, a serious investigation of the Albanian mob isn't going to happen because they're our boys. They're protected. And just sort of thinking about that, I don't fully know the storyline for, you know, GTA 4, sorry to bring gaming into it, but I thought it was interesting because the character, you know, his name Nico, isn't it? Yeah. You know, says about, you know, the horrible things he'd done, you know, over in Eastern Europe. So, you know, one imagines that he was probably either a member of the Albanian mafia or possibly a member of the KLA, either way. It says, the KLA, Albanian Mafia Network, camouflages the blonde-haired, blue-eyed Bosnians and Albanians who are bin Laden's operatives. After the last attack, we're all looking for Arab suspects, but it's not going to be that easy. Former KLA forces continue to be active in Macedonia under the banner of the NLA, largely at the instigation of US military intelligence, long after the end of the Kosovo conflict and the demise of the Milosevic regime in Yugoslavia. The BBC reported near the end of January 2001 that Western Special Forces were still training KLA guerrillas. According to foreign diplomatic sources, the former KLA had several hundred fighters in the 5-kilometer-deep military exclusion zone on the boundary between Kosovo and the rest of Serbia. In addition, certain NATO-led K4 forces were not preventing the guerrillas taking mortars and other weapons into the exclusion zone. The guerrillas' units had been able to hold exercises there, including live firing of weapons, despite the fact that K4 patrols the zone. Western Special Forces were still training the guerrillas as a result of decisions taken before the change of government in Yugoslavia. In May 2001, US diplomat Robert Fenwick, head of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, held a secret meeting in Prizren, Kosovo, with Albanian and former KLA NLA leaders, to which Macedonian officials were not invited. According to James Bissett, former Canadian ambassador to Yugoslavia, Bulgaria and Albania from 1990 to 1992, the meeting made clear that the United States was backing the Albanian terrorist cause. 1 month later, 400 former NLA fighters were surrounded by Macedonian security forces in the town of Arseninovo near the capital Skopje. Just as they began moving in, suddenly NATO ordered them to pull back. Subsequently, US Army buses from the camp Bonsteel, Kosovo, swept in to escort the NLA fighters to safety. By August 2001, Scott Taylor, Canada's top war reporter, former soldier and editor of Esprit de Corps military magazine, reported in detail how he witnessed firsthand in Tetovo the clandestine American and British support for the ethnic Albanian guerrillas at the height of their anti-Macedonian insurgency. Noting that such support is vehemently denied by officials, Taylor pointed out that there's no denying the massive amount of material and expertise supplied by NATO to the guerrillas. The UCK, or NLA commanders, welcomed me with a shout of, "God bless America and Canada, too, for all that they have provided for us." In the well-constructed UCK bunkers overlooking the besieged town of Tetovo, there is ample evidence of US military hardware. Everything from sidearms and sniper rifles to menacing-looking grenade launchers are emblazoned with a Made in the USA logo. An abundant stock of sophisticated night vision goggles provides the UCK with a tremendous tactical advantage over the Macedonian security forces. By nightfall, the Macedonians are compelled to hole up in their bunkers while the UCK roam with impunity throughout the Tetovo streets. Snake Arifaj, a 22-year-old platoon commander of the UCK, proudly displayed his unit's impressive arsenal and said, "Thanks to Uncle Sam, the Macedonians are no match for us." The extent of US support to the guerrillas was highlighted in early August 2001 when the Macedonian government loudly protested the delivery of supplies by two US helicopters to an Albanian village in the mountains above Tetovo. US spokesperson said the helicopters were only providing much needed humanitarian assistance. The reality of the matter, however, was revealed by a local NLA commander known only as Commandant Mouse, who confirmed that the supplies had consisted of heavy mortars and ammunition to the NLA. As if to vindicate his claim, on August the 16th, the NLA began firing 120mm and 82mm mortars at Tetovo. Taylor, who witnessed the mortar attacks, argues that their duration and intensity proves that the NLA is receiving a continuous and abundant supply of ammunition. US military assistance to the ethnic Albanian guerrillas was also more direct. According to Taylor, the US also frequently used their tactical helicopters to gather intelligence inside Macedonia without authorization from the Macedonian government. The sight of the US choppers prompted the ethnic Albanian villagers to cheer wildly, waving their arms to encourage their air force. In what appeared to be a welcome turnaround to this policy, in summer 2001, President George W. Bush signed two decrees purportedly depriving Albanian extremists who were threatening the stability of Macedonia of all financial or material support, barring them from entry into the United States. But as George Zamuli reported, the US decrees were more rhetoric than reality. As an Irish Times report put it sarcastically, Commander Rustrem earned fame during the Kosovo War as one of the most successful guerrilla commanders. He has since become a favourite with NATO commanders, whose glowing commendations line the walls of his office. Certainly, if the Americans have reservations about him, they have yet to show it. On Tuesday, two separate US Army teams came to his base to train his men. Well, I must admit, I'm getting hungry because I haven't eaten yet, and there's quite a few more pages to go with this, so if you want to learn more about this, I'll keep it held at this place, and we'll continue revealing the lies and deceit that that we are bombarded with. Or should I say, yeah, you know, because it is lies and deceit, isn't it? That we're told one thing, but this is what really goes on behind the scenes. So, brothers and sisters, if the Lord wills it, if it pleases to do so, may He bless you. May He watch over you, may He guide and protect you, and so that you may glorify Him and it be for your greater good. So on that note, I'll say bye for now.